Hello, everyone. I'm Kate Snow, senior national correspondent for NBC News and anchor of NBC Nightly News Sunday. I am pleased to welcome you to the 27th annual DART Awards for Excellence in Coverage of Trauma. Every year, the DART Center for Journalism and Trauma at Columbia Journalism School recognizes outstanding reporting that portrays traumatic events and their aftermath with accuracy, insight, and dignity, while illuminating the impact of violence, crisis, and tragedy on individuals, families, and communities. These are hard but essential stories, stories that bear witness and expose abuse, stories which bring connection to survivors, stories which sometimes change the world. As journalists, it's our job to tell these stories with sensitivity and care. That commitment was severely tested in 2020 amid the pandemic, social upheaval, and sweeping challenges to injustice. This year's DART honorees met the challenge. All of the stories you're about to hear tonight set new standards for rigorous, compassionate, high-impact reporting on the most devastating human experiences. I'll be back later to tell you about the winners, and then you'll enjoy live conversations with the honorees. In the meantime, it is my pleasure to introduce Bruce Shapiro, Executive Director of the DART Center for Journalism and Trauma, who will tell you a little bit more about the DART Awards and the DART Center's important work.
Thank you, Kate Snow, and welcome everyone to the 27th annual DART Awards, honoring outstanding reporting on trauma in 2020. The DART Center for Journalism and Trauma, a project of Columbia Journalism School, nurtures innovative, ethical reporting on violence, crisis, and tragedy, focused both on the craft challenges of reporting on trauma and on appreciating and understanding and mitigating the impact of covering trauma on news professionals. Whether you're an old DART friend or attending these awards for the first time, you are here because you too believe in that mission. Every year I introduce the DART Awards with a few thoughts about why journalism focused on life's most difficult experiences matters. This year, it's a challenge to find the right words. The simple reality is that we're honoring reporting for a year in which nearly 400,000 people in the US alone died of COVID-19, in which millions more were hospitalized and all of our lives were upended. A year in which we witnessed the murder of George Floyd, captured on video by a courageous teenager, igniting a national reckoning with racism, even within our own news industry. A year when we witnessed the violent attack on the seat of American democracy, and at the same time, the toppling of historic monuments to white supremacy, all happening alongside the persistent, metastasizing public health crisis. Throughout this anguished and harrowing period, journalists and newsrooms around the country put themselves on the line, as did colleagues around the world. In 2020, all journalists were trauma reporters. This year's DART Awards winners and honorees powerfully reflect this time in diverse ways. In addition to our signature DART Awards, we added a special award for outstanding reporting on the psychosocial impact of the pandemic. Many entries and two of our winners reflected newsrooms grappling with police violence, with institutional racism, and the Black Lives Matter movement. But it was also striking that amid such overwhelming events, so many newsrooms properly insisted that the job of investigating and illuminating those less visible tragedies, abuses, and traumas had to continue. You'll hear about that too when you meet this year's extraordinary DART Award honorees. Amid the unprecedented challenges of 2020, the DART Awards remain true to the vision established with the very first DART Award in 1994, honoring compassionate, ethical reporting on violence, crisis, and tragedy, portraying victims and survivors of trauma with dignity, reporting animated by the insights of trauma science, stories which blaze a path for future reporters, charting resilience as well as injury, justice as well as victimization. And just as in 1994, The DART Awards are a team prize. Indeed, never has it been more clear than this past year that high-impact trauma reporting demands extraordinary commitment across an entire newsroom. It's now my pleasure to introduce three great friends of the DART Center and trauma-aware journalism, without whose support these awards would not be possible. We'll hear from Steve Call, Dean of Columbia Journalism School, Jim Lammers, Chair of DART Container Corporation, and Chris Duggan, representing the Kenneth B. DART Foundation. And then I'll return to talk more with Kate Snow and with all of you.
I'm Steve Call, and I too want to welcome you to this virtual DART Awards evening. Here at Columbia Journalism School, our students have grappled with the same challenges as reporters everywhere, covering waves of pandemic, protests for social justice, all at a time of persistent attacks on journalism and science. Throughout, our students have been very fortunate to have the DART Center as a resource, helping them understand how to ethically report on vulnerable individuals, families, and communities, how to tell rich, insightful stories on grief, loss, recovery, and resilience, how to stay safe and take care of themselves while reporting in these sometimes stressful times. As we enter the next phase of this pandemic, news organizations all over the world are turning to the DART Center for very practical training and advice. And they're smart to do so. The DART Center has made distinctive, vital contributions to journalism by infusing journalism practice with the best insights from psychology, neuroscience, and other fields of scholarship. The center has developed a special authority and influence that I think is strengthened by being housed at this great research university and in our global-minded journalism school. For all these reasons, we're deeply grateful to Ken DART for his vision and for his support of these awards and for the whole DART Center enterprise, which has done so much to strengthen our school. Tonight, though, is about journalism, so I just want to say to this year's DART Award honorees, I hope you enjoy this opportunity to have your reporting celebrated. Your work exemplifies excellence and commitment to the public interest. And I know that students and others will benefit tonight enormously from hearing you talk about how your work came about. I'm sure you'll inspire all of us once again with your rigor and with your achievements. Congratulations to everybody.
Hi, everyone. I'm Jim Lammers, Chair of the DART Container Corporation Board of Directors. I've had the pleasure of working with the DART Center since its founding in 1999. In 1994, the DART Foundation, established by the late William A. DART and his wife, Claire T. DART, launched the annual DART Awards with a simple idea: honoring compassionate, dignified reporting on victims of violence. The experiment worked, attracting powerful entries from some of the country's great newsrooms. 5 years later, the DART Awards were folded into the new DART Center for Journalism and Trauma, today housed at Columbia Journalism School. In 2014, a second generation picked up the torch. Kenneth B. DART made the first in a series of gifts, which have kept the DART Center at the forefront of journalism innovation. I've been struck over the years at how the DART Center has risen to meet so many challenges and crises. 20 years ago, after the 9/11 attacks, the center launched DART Center Ground Zero, bringing support and resources to journalists covering the attacks' aftermath and recovery. This year, the DART Center has reinvented its work on Zoom, reaching directly into newsrooms worldwide, and is presenting a special DART award for reporting on the psychosocial impact of COVID-19. Through all these changes, the DART Center and the DART Awards have never deviated from that core commitment to compassion, ethics, and scientifically informed reporting. Congratulations to all of this year's honorees. Your reporting is part of a great tradition, which matters now more than ever.
Good evening to you all. My name is Chris Duggan, and it is my pleasure to once again represent Ken DART and the Kenneth B. DART Foundation at this evening's DART Awards ceremony. As he does every year, Ken sends his very best to you all with a particular message of congratulations to all of this evening's outstanding winners. This is the second year now in which COVID-19 prevents us all from meeting in person. But the pandemic really does reinforce the importance and the value of informed, compassionate reporting on trauma and resilience. The lessons from this year's DART Awards stories are exactly what the world needs to hear right now. And I would like to congratulate this year's winners on their incredible work. Every year I am blown away by the dedication and the insight of the DART Award winners. And I always gain so much fresh understanding and appreciation from hearing them discuss their work. This year is again no different, and I would like to thank our winners for their many sacrifices and their steadfast commitment to bringing us these inspiring stories. While I really miss celebrating with you all in person, I'm delighted that such a large worldwide audience can now be a part of this evening and get the opportunity to meet our extraordinary DART Award honorees. I hope you all have a great evening, and congratulations again to all of our honorees. It's now my pleasure to turn you back to NBC's Kate Snow, who will introduce you to this year's DART Award honorees.
Before I introduce you to this year's DART Award honorees, I just want to say how proud I am to be in their company. These reporters are telling stories about vulnerability and tragedy, but also about resilience and how one person can make a difference. And they do it with compassion. They show that great journalists are not just accurate, but also human and humane. The DART Center is unique in supporting this kind of ethical, high-impact reporting on trauma and its aftermath, and that support is truly appreciated. So now let's recognize the 2021 DART Award honorees, six innovative projects published or broadcast last year, spotlighting the experiences of victims and survivors that make significant contributions to the public's understanding of trauma and resilience.
Mientras yo tenga alternativa de correr, yo voy a correr, yo voy a correr. Y yo voy a morir de viejo, porque yo no voy a ser víctima de las balas de nadie.
Univision received an honorable mention for Trapped in Mexico, which examines a Trump administration policy that meant asylum seekers had to wait in some of the most dangerous cities in Mexico.
And they can't release him. Now, we did win a great court case last night. Go back to Mexico.
The Trump administration's controversial Remain in Mexico policy may be illegal. That's according to some officials.
La administración de Presidente Trump ha destruido el derecho de asilo.
Tener que firmar la aplicación suya.
Y se va a tomar tres décadas para poder recuperar a un costo tremendo.
Judges describe the project as a staggering reporting feat that balances insightful data with expansive visuals and hard-hitting reporting. They commended the unique sensitivity and slow pace of the storytelling, which they said mirrors the slow pace of the subject's asylum cases.
You know, he woke up one morning and he was just Floyd. He was Big Floyd. That was that morning he woke up. And that night he got killed, he was a martyr.
The Star Tribune received an honorable mention for its coverage of the murder of George Floyd and its aftermath in Minneapolis and around the world.
But would I still rather him be here today? Yes. I would still rather look at him today and be able to speak to him, be able to talk to him today, yeah. I would rather that.
Judges described Maya Rao's profile as gripping and powerful, calling it the definitive George Floyd story. They described the series as outstanding and applauded the team for helping readers understand that trauma doesn't end easily or soon, but when addressed properly, it can become a catalyst for major change.
George Floyd! George Floyd!
Before COVID, I would probably do one body every month. Going from one a month to 15 to 20 a day. It was overwhelming. just thinking to myself, like, is this really happening? Like, people are really dying like this? Like, am I dreaming? Am I gonna wake up from this dream?
Time magazine received an honorable mention for Contagion of Fear, which tells the story of Wyckoff Hospital in Brooklyn at the height of the pandemic. The piece focuses on the trauma experienced by the healthcare workers and the impact of fear on medical workers, patients, and hospital personnel. Judges described the piece as deeply insightful and profoundly affecting immersive reporting. They praised Schuster for allowing people to speak for themselves, free of judgment or editorializing, and they called Kohut's photographs revelatory.
Derek, could you acknowledge me, please? I'm treating you like a gentleman.
Oh, okay. I'm so overwhelmed.
I'm treating you like a gentleman.
I just want to get this over with. I'm like, it's too much. It's too much.
I hear you. One wrong move, they will probably shoot him down.
Gimlet and Spotify received a DART award for Shake the Room. This episode of the Resistance podcast tells the story of a nearly six-hour standoff between Derek Ingram and the NYPD. Judges described the piece as brilliant storytelling, at turns riveting, enraging, funny, and deeply moving. They said it depicts a kind of trauma, menacing situations of indignity and harassment that far too many people of color in this country are familiar with.
Who in Alaska is going to listen to me? That's what I asked myself, and honestly, they wouldn't have. So I didn't do it. I let those men walk free because I was not strong enough to endure what had happened to me over again.
The Anchorage Daily News and ProPublica received a DART award for Unheard, which focuses on 29 women and men seeking to inspire change in Alaska's justice system and to destigmatize being a survivor of sexual violence. Judges called the project exceptional, original journalism that puts the voices of survivors at the forefront and reimagines how trauma-aware, culturally sensitive, collaborative reporting can be done. They applauded the project's emphasis on the heterogeneity of sexual violence and trauma and called the reporting approach sensitive by design.
Kenny was like the Energizer Bunny.
His love of life and going to Dunkin' Donuts.
See, I never had a bad day. Some are just better than others.
He always gave us a dollar when he came on the weekends.
Just a good parent.
He loved fiercely. He loved all of us so fiercely.
The Associated Press received the DART Award for outstanding coverage of the COVID-19 crisis for Lives Lost, which tells the story of 60 ordinary people across 20 countries. The project captures the pandemic scale, the impact of each death on those left behind, and how trauma has been playing out across communities, countries, and cultures. Judges called Lives Lost an astonishingly powerful, multi-layered package that reveals the devastating global-scale loss that the virus has had on humanity. They commended AP for its tremendous institutional commitment to a beautiful project of human portraits, despite the onslaught of daily news. It has really been my pleasure to highlight the important work of this year's DART Award honorees. Congratulations to all. Now back over to the DART Center's Bruce Shapiro and a series of conversations about this remarkable reporting.
Thank you, Kate Snow, for that generous introduction to this year's DART Awards honorees. Apologies to all of you for a couple moments of dead air, the perils of Zoom. Now, if we were together in Pulitzer Hall, I would be inviting all of you to raise a glass of champagne in a toast. Instead, we are here on Zoom, scattered all over the planet. I know, though, that everyone here joins me in a global virtual ovation for such extraordinary, visionary, courageous reporting. We're now at the heart of the evening, conversation with the journalists whose work you've just heard about. To respect both the range of honorees and the sweeping events of this year, I'm going to lead not one, but three discussions of about 15 minutes each. The first on covering race, policing, and the Black Lives Matter movement. The second on reporting on mental health, vulnerable people, and policy reform. And the third on covering the COVID-19 pandemic. Then we'll have time for a Q&A with all of our panelists. If, as the panels go on, you have questions, please ask them via the Zoom QA feature, and if directed toward a particular panelist, indicate that. The DART Center's ace Zoom team will steer questions to me. We're now going to go to our first group, reporting on race, policing, and the Black Lives Matter movement. For this, we're going to be joined by Saeed Tejan Thomas Jr. from Gimlet and Spotify, and the Resistance podcast for his episode, Shake the Room, which you heard an excerpt from, and Maya Rao from the Star Tribune in Minneapolis for George Floyd coverage, and in particular, the lengthy profile of Mr. Floyd's life, which spanned 3 days of the Star Tribune's coverage at the peak of the crisis. Saeed, I'm gonna start with you. As I was listening to your remarkable piece about Derek's encounter with the NYPD at his apartment door, it struck me that in a kind of a conventional news sense, this was a story in which there wasn't a lot of news. The police, the NYPD shows up to serve a warrant. Derek didn't want to answer the door. The warrant wasn't served. The cops eventually went away. There was no blood spilled, no dramatic arrest on camera, none of the usual stuff that makes headlines happen. You made this the heart of your story. Talk a little bit about why this story that wouldn't have even been a blip on the news radar in a lot of ways.
Yeah, that's a good point, and that's a great question. I think what Derek, It wasn't news, and I think I don't think I was like particularly interested in like a newsy angle on this at all. I had been spending a lot of time with Derek and his group Warriors in the Garden, a lot of time with them over the summer, and I kind of got to know Derek a little bit, but not too much. And I think with Derek, what made this particular event so important to give attention to was the fact that it wasn't the first time Derek had experienced something like this in his own life. He had had friends who had experienced similar things, and he had been harassed by cops throughout his time as a protester on the streets of New York. And to then have them come to his door and do what they did, I think was like, It was another step. It was a step too far, and it was a thing that like triggered all his past traumas, and it was NYPD, quite frankly, taking the fight to his front door and bringing it right to where he lived, and I think it was important to sort of showcase what that kind of crossing of boundaries looks like and the kind of effects it has on a protester who is usually having those fights outside in the streets.
Yeah, one of the things that struck me is that, you know, when we are reporting on the experiences of people who are traumatized, so often it's about kind of the present tense playing out of long ago stuff in the past. But from our psychologist friends, we know that trauma begins with great fear. And what you really depicted in this particular podcast episode was the presence of terror in real time. Talk a little bit about how you were able to do that. Through what Derek and some of his activist colleagues had provided their responses at the time. How were you able to really let Derek narrate terror mm-hmm. unfolding in someone's life?
Yeah. I think the way we were able to do it was like actually focusing on everything outside of the terror, all the mundane everyday things that he was doing that led to the terrorizing moment. I think if we had gone in and we had just said, all right, we're going to drop you straight into the middle of the scene where he's like at his wit's end and it was like really tragic for him, then you wouldn't, I don't think it would have really come across what was at stake for Derek. I think we had to really build out what his night before was like with his friends, what his past was, what his history was, what his history with police was, what his history with protesting was. And just like what a 20-something year old kid would be doing after a night of partying when he gets home before this all unfolds. I think what really made the terror come across was just like, I could see myself in Derek, and I think anybody else could see themselves in Derek as well.
And as you said, also all of the normal. Mm-hmm. The segment begins with so much that's normal mm-hmm. and calm. And violence and racism and fear of the police are normal too, but that the calm of someone who has a hangover from a party the night before, from too much drinking, of someone who's just trying to figure out his day when suddenly the police are at the door. The piece does go, as you've said, back to his past and the ways in which, in particular, one friend's encounter with the police shapes and informs the terror of the moment. Talk a little bit about that and how you got there with Derek. It's not always easy for people who are dealing with present tense distress to recollect what they're also carrying around from before. Talk a little about
that. Yeah, a lot of what these guys are doing out there is with their friends, right? Like a lot of what they're doing on the streets, these protesters, these young protesters is with their homies. And I had known that Derek had a friend who was killed by cops. And when I arrived at his apartment that day to interview him, that was front of mind for me, that I needed to ask him not just about what he went through, but what his friends had been going through. I realized he had some pictures of all his friends back home in sitting on his mantle in his house. So I asked him about that, and we talked about his friends for a long time before we actually got to what happened that day. So when we got to what happened that day, that was in his mind. That's something that he had been thinking about and something he'd been processing. So he was able to put the two pieces together and felt really comfortable talking about that with me, because we had spent so much time just laying down the groundwork of like how his relationships with his friends plays into all this.
Mm. Maya, since we're talking about the past, your piece too was about delving far back into Mr. Floyd's past. It struck me as I was going over your work today that the world, of course, very quickly knew who George Floyd was. The world very quickly knew what happened to him. But for you and your colleagues at the Star Tribune, this was a community story, a local story involving places you and your team all know, institutions you report on in an ongoing way. This is not parachute reporting. This is community reporting. When it came to telling Mr. Floyd's own story, you made the decision, first of all, to go deep, to go long, to run the story over several days. and to approach it in a really complex way. Talk about the conversations you had in the newsroom, maybe that led to this particular approach when the whole world has already descended on Minneapolis and thinks they've got the story tied up. You took a particular approach. Talk about that a little bit.
Right. One of the interesting things about George Floyd was that he spent most of his life in Houston, and he had only come to Minnesota and been living there for the last couple of years. So one of the things that was really intriguing to me is, how did he end up here? And I remember sitting down with somebody who had helped him get up here. And we were talking about how there had actually been a whole pipeline of men coming from Houston to Minneapolis to turn their lives around. And that fit into a broader pattern I had been familiar with just over the years. I'd heard about a lot of African Americans coming from southern states or often from Chicago. They had come to Minneapolis for better economic opportunities, a safer environment, just an opportunity to turn their lives around. So I thought that was really interesting when his friend told me he had actually really come to save his life. You know, he was in a neighborhood that had a lot of gun violence, a lot of drugs. I mean, this was an opportunity to really, you know, rescue himself, and only to die a couple of years later was just astonishing in a state that really prides itself on being a welcoming place. So, you know, there's so many directions you could go with writing a profile of Floyd, but I wanted to just set some boundaries and tell, you know, the first part was just kind of taking people to that scene that I thought was powerful, you know, when he calls his friend, another Houston to Minneapolis transplant who had already been here, you know, calling him for help and asking him to buy his bus ticket so he can join him and some of their other friends there, all African-American men from the same neighborhood. So I kind of wanted to start with that scene and take people back just enough of his life in Houston so people knew why he felt he had to come up here, but then take the next couple, you know, parts of the story to really just delve into his life in Minnesota. And it actually did not run on 3 days. It was three parts, but we ran it in a special report in one day.
Yeah.
I actually had pitched it originally for 3 days. I had tried to structure it with some suspense, yeah, and my editors thought it would be easier to run it as a special report.
Yes.
And, my, you know,
correction gratefully accepted.
Yeah. I mean, this is, I think, one of the longest stories the Star Tribune has ever written, and that was not my intention when I started out. I think I would have freaked my editors out if I, you know, came to them with that right away, but it was, I just let the reporting dictate it, and it just felt like there was so much there, and we had so much to work with, so I just started writing, and that's kind of how it came to be.
One of the things I know that young reporters often wonder about now is how to approach families that are in grief, or how to approach friends are in grief when you're doing this kind of a piece, and do it in a way that evokes complexity, not just kind of cliches. Did you find that Mr. Floyd's friends and broader social circle were keen to talk to you? Were they suspicious of the media? What was that dynamic like?
Well, you know, a lot of people didn't necessarily want to talk, but I think not because they had any particular antagonism to us. I think it was just really painful, and they're used to being bombarded with the media. You know, so I mean, definitely these people have all, you know, and oftentimes been approached by many people, you know, CNN or New York Times. I mean, sometimes people just get tired of talking. But yeah, my approach has been to just kind of start off with a phone call and try to sit down with people and kind of just keep coming back to them. And, mm-hmm, you know, once people see that you're serious about really taking a lot of time and not rushing them, they really open up more. But, you know, there were, I would say, you know, George Floyd's girlfriend, Courtney Ross, she was a really amazing source for the piece, but I know it seemed to be it was very emotionally wrenching for her at times, or she, you know, she would break into tears. You know, so it was tough sometimes just trying to get people to open up. But in the story, I mean, you know, one thing I thought it was important to make sure that I really in parallel to Floyd's story, told the story of some of his peers. Since Floyd was dead and we'll never fully know everything about him, you know, he had these peers who were Black men about the same age who had also migrated from Houston to Minneapolis. So, you know, I was able to get several of them to really open up to me about their stories.
And what struck me is how much they were willing to share complexity with you. Not all of these were success stories in life. Talk a little bit about that, about how and why you think people were willing to talk about their own vulnerability, not just their successes.
Right. One person I focused a lot in on the story was a man named Robert Fontenot. He had grown up in the same neighborhood as George Floyd. He wasn't like a super close friend, but, you know, he was just a peer a couple years older. And, you know, he, like Floyd, had dealt with this similar issues of falling into a cycle of drug use and needing to kind of get away from Houston, try to start over. And so I just sat, I remember our first conversation was at a Denny's and the snow was falling and we were there for 5 hours. And I know, I think he opened up because he was saying he had been frustrated that a lot of the Floyd coverage seemed to be kind of superficial. It was shorter stories. So, you know, and I had shown a willingness to really sit down with him for a while. The story just came out and he's going back to school now to become a drug addiction counselor. So he thought the story could kind of help inspire people. But yeah, I mean, that's always a challenge, especially, you know, I mean, the people, you know, Floyd's peers as well as Floyd have dealt with drug addiction. And there's always a concern about how to tell that story thoughtfully, you know, in a climate where readers or just the general public can be insensitive about it.
I think, you know, most of us viewing Mr. Floyd's life from the outside are riveted by the images of his death. Were there specific choices that you made, images or words or pictures that you put in because they seem to so strongly offer a counter narrative, give people a different picture than the final moments of someone's life?
Yeah, well, I mean, one thing we talked about a lot was just everybody knows so much about this man and all about how he died. That's how he's being defined in the world. They don't know much about his life before then. And because, you know, after he died and information came out, a lot of people kind of just put him in this box as somebody who was a drug user. But when I was talking to people about him, one of the strong themes that came up was just how much he really was a people person. His Christian faith was very important to him. He was a very complicated man. And so as much as I could, you know, I tried to figure out a way to kind of just balance that out. And I sat down with his roommate who showed me Floyd's Bible and the passages he underlined. Courtney Ross, his girlfriend, showed me she kept a lot of his notes he would write to himself or different lines of rap or goals he set for himself. When I do these kinds of stories, I always want to get people's words as much as I can. And, you know, that scene with him dying on video, that's just a terrible way to be known to the world. And, you know, there were so many other sides to him.
So in a sense, what you were doing was reintroducing the world to someone who the world thought they knew in a very terrible and kind of reductionist way. And you said, no, here's actually what this person, what their life is about, what their life is like. You retold the story. I think that's really important. We will come back to both of you, but now I have to do my panel swap so that we can deal with all of the rich and complex reporting we've got here today. Our second group, which is going to focus on reporting centered on mental health challenges, on vulnerable people, on policy and reform in that area, will be Adriana Gerardo from the Anchorage Daily News and Patricia Clarimbeau from Univision for Trapped in Mexico. And I think, Patricia, I'm going to start out with you on this. And I'd ask our audience to think back to the video that we just saw a few minutes ago that summarized your story. It happened at a time when the Trump administration articulated a policy called Remain in Mexico, which for asylum seekers really meant, as your title says, trapped in Mexico. You decided to focus on the mental health impact of this protracted virtual imprisonment at the border rather than the traditional American asylum process. And, you know, that on the surface, that sounds like, oh yeah, duh, let's talk about the mental health thing. But you point out early in the story that there was no data. There was no one who really had put together the information on what the mental health impact of being refused admission to the U.S., of what being trapped in migrant camps and other kinds of places on the other side of the border, being uncertain of your future, what that all meant. What was your, once you decided on this mental health direction, what was your method for getting the data that didn't exist, getting the evidence, beginning to peel back the onion of this challenging story?
Yes, well, when we started to interview people, we knew that people were coming from countries that were really violent. So violence was a common element that we found in them. So when you, then we, the first interviews we did were in Tijuana. And it was just 2 months after this policy began to be applied in the border. And when we continued the reporting, we saw that people was not only being a victim in their countries, they were victims in the border. They were being, they were suffering extortions. They were being kidnapped with their kids, for example. And they felt really alone in the middle of this policy that were, stopping them on their objectives that were seeking for a protection in the US because they were victims. So what we then decided was to follow up on these stories because we wanted to show the process that people were going through, you know? And that's why we took like more than a year and a half on the reporting. And there were like several interviews with the migrants that you saw in the video and that are in the text and everywhere in the pictures. And we tried to follow all of the process they were living in that time. And then we can illustrate not only the trauma they were facing in their countries, but also the trauma that they were living in the border while they were under ICE custody, for example. And what happened when they were deported to the countries they, you know, fled. So it was like a long process to have this data that was not a numeric one. It was not, we cannot say 20 migrants, but we for sure can say that all of them, all of the people that we talked at that time and during all the reporting were suffering a lot of trauma. Yeah.
Did you find yourself turning to having to develop mental health professionals as resources, people who could advise you in pursuing this story?
Well, we talked to many of the lawyers that were in the field and they were helping us to understand the processes that they were living, you know. We don't use counseling at that time, but, you know, we have been covering immigration for years. And the toll in the reporting too is really high. And for sure, I think that at some point we are going to need it. Yeah.
Well, and what about as to help you understand the public health impact, the psychological impact on these individuals and communities. You built a lot of science into your mm-hmm. story where you started out with no data, right? How did you think about that?
Yeah, well, at that time, we were calling organizations, people who were suffering or had suffered PTSD, for example, and they can compare what they, and for example, it was a veteran who helped us compare his PTSD with the one these migrants were suffering. And he could say for sure, you know, I can say these people that I'm helping every day here in Matamoros, because he was leaving food and, you know, helping these people. And he was like the first people, the first person who told us, I can compare my PTSD with the ones, the one these people is suffering. Then we talked to some NGOs in the field who were measuring the consequences of this, and they confirmed that the mental health was a problem in people, because as you can imagine, they were not only waiting for seeking asylum, you know, or to get their day in court. They were like in Matamoros, for example, where this campground was built by migrants. They were scared of being kidnapped or killed. You know, they were with their kids. Many of them decided to leave their kids to cross alone the border because they didn't see their cases that it could be successful, you know. So yeah, many people, including NGOs, Médicos Sin Fronteras, for example, they confirmed people was having a real toll on mental health, and there were no enough people to help them, you know, and to give them a comfort they need, or they couldn't even say, your case is gonna take 2 days or 20 days. They were waiting for, you know, months in places like Matamoros. So yeah, we consult people in this, yeah.
And one last thing, when reporting on kind of an epidemic of mental health crises, uh-huh. in a group of migrants like this, it's easy for that to be an abstraction, to be a number, or to hear about PTSD or depression, and it's just sort of there. But you're working for Univision. What does a mental health crisis look like? How did you make this real and vivid, whether with visuals, whether with sound, whether with narrative? Mm-hmm. How did you make a mental health crisis vivid for news consumers?
Yeah, the first thing that I could say is that the testimony of these people is strong. You know, they are really victims. They are suffering a lot. And we don't, in some cases, we just need to hear them to know that they were suffering and they were victims. But we also decided to show it on with pictures, for example, of parents that were hanging like teddy bears of their kids that were sent to the across the border, you know. Yeah. And that was really strong in Matamoros, because you can feel the desperation of these parents when they say, I know that I have nothing to do with this, and I sent my kid, my 8-year-old kid, because I know that he will be successful and I want him to be protected. I don't care what happened with me, you know. And well, when we decided to use photography and video, is because the elements were so explicit over there, you know. And when people talk, it was like an immediate relationship between their histories and the suffering they were. You don't have to make a big effort, you know, to show the trauma when it is over there and it's like being extended by months and years, you know.
Yeah. Adriana, when you with ProPublica and your colleagues at the Anchorage Daily News decided to tell the stories of a wide range of sexual assault survivors in Alaska. You too depended on testimony. And I should say, by the way, for the record, as a matter of history, that the Anchorage Daily News is now a two-time DART Award winner. It won the very first DART Award in 1994. For a piece about survivors of sexual abuse and violence. So it's a wonderful thing to see that the tradition continuing. But, you know, when you and your colleagues decided to bring a survivor's eye perspective to the failures of the criminal justice system and the failures of sort of the social contract in Alaska to protect people from sexual violence and sexual abuse. Many of them were from indigenous communities or other really vulnerable communities. Many were people who've been discarded by the justice system. You decided on an unusual, really innovative, collaborative approach. Can you talk a little bit about that? I think that is going to resonate a lot, especially for journalists in the room today.
Sure, yes, thank you for having me. And this piece came, you know, Kyle Hopkins and the team at the Anchorage Daily News had been in partnership with ProPublica for about a year, reporting on the lack of law enforcement throughout the state. And Kyle had spelled out in great detail the failures of those systems. What my team at ProPublica focuses on is crowdsourcing around these investigative series and really digging deep with the folks who are enduring the brunt of these systemic failures. So for this, it looked like we put out a form online mimicked by one that the Anchorage Daily News had done a few months earlier and asked folks to share their stories. And much to our surprise, we heard from hundreds of people. And really what the piece turned out to be was not ever anything that we honestly did by design. It sort of built itself as we went. And I always think of it as we told it how we heard it. You know, we had hundreds of people volunteer to tell their story. We spoke to dozens and dozens of them. And in some ways, it was very much how it began to feel for myself and my colleague, Nadia Sussman, who did almost every single interview with me. And we very quickly learned that, you know, we were meeting these folks because of tremendous trauma, but we were also meeting them as people who had the most resilient feats. And so we really wanted to bake that into the, you know, we're going to tell a bit of your story, right? That was the other negotiation we did, was that no one person was going to carry the burden of explaining systemic failure for generations in the state, right? Mm-hmm. And so we said, you know, we'll highlight a thing that's important to you about your story. Mm-hmm. And we went as far as allowing the sources to design the photography. So a lot of the images that you see in the piece were designed by the sources themselves, which took a great amount of input from everyone involved. All the photographers were based at the Anchorage Daily News. And so, you know, as we were building the stories with our folks, we also said, take us to the place that makes you feel whole, take us to someone who helped you in your recovery, show us what you wear to feel like yourself. And each person, you know, as part of the contract of participating in the piece, gave us those items.
So you didn't just say, hey, how do you want your picture taken? You gave people some specific suggestions and guidance that would bring in places, images, whatever, that could then become pictures. So it really was a visual collaboration.
Yes. Yeah, in many ways. And the photographers traveled 10,000 miles throughout the state under incredible weather conditions in Alaska, to say the least. And so to make these portraits, because we really felt it was important to get the portrait that these folks who were already volunteering so much of themselves, for them to be proud of what they looked like when this ran and when they were, we always, you know, when it became apparent that we would be telling the stories en masse as a group, no one knew who else was in the group, but they knew that there was 20 some other folks coming out with them and that the piece would be a collection much more than a single, you know, them being put on the spotlight. We did isolate them. The pieces ran for a month and on the cover of the Anchorage Daily News. And so for that day, they did hold the space on their own, but by and large, it was, you know, there was 20 some others who were there with them.
I teach an ethics class here at Columbia, journalism ethics class, and one of the challenges my students often talk about is the tension between I believe you and the need for verification, accuracy, factuality, all those traditional journalism verities. In this really collaborative process that you created to carry forward the testimonies of survivors, how did you manage that? How did the accuracy versus I believe you, the verification versus collaboration, et cetera, go? What was that like?
That's a great question. We went out of our way to formalize what it meant to be believed. So almost leaning into the difficulty of one, not wanting to mimic the judicial system that had often done so much harm to these folks, right? So in many ways we said, you know, we're gonna need to prove that everything that prints is true. And these are the ways that looks like in journalism. And we were very explicit to have these conversations and follow up in writing so that they would have time to ponder the, you know, what we were going to be asking for moving forward. There was a contract for each that we sent. We didn't call it a contract, but we said, this is what it means to keep moving forward. We're going to, you know, be making these phone calls. We're going to work with your therapist potentially to release some of the records of the care you've been receiving. Mm-hmm. We're going to look at your journals. We're going to ask folks who were there when it happened. So it was really a case by case for each of the profiles in what we were illustrating. And we also framed it, which I think is helpful, is in protecting them as sources and protecting ourselves as the people putting this together. So in many ways, it still felt collaborative to fact check, right? It still felt like it was part of the process.
And it also sounds as if you took it on yourselves in a gentle and respectful way to educate people about the journalism process that they were now part of, almost as if they were new reporters, almost that okay, we're in journalism now. Here's what it's going to mean to do this. There was a kind of education that you did.
Yes.
Yeah. Did you lose a lot of folks because of this education and contract process?
No, because the process was so long. I mean, these folks, the folks that appear on the pages of this collection were with us for a year working on this, right? So there were many opportunities for them to turn around before publication. And if you get to the bottom of the piece, there's a space that we called the space of silence dedicated to all those who weren't yet ready to share their story. That came from someone who worked with us for the entire year, was one of the folks that really guided us, and very close to publication, they decided not to be a part of it. And she said, mm-hmm. What about me? And what about all the other folks like me who do want to tell their story? We're just not there yet. And it was her idea to do this. So in many ways, we tried to build a space for those as well. There was a handful who didn't make it to publication, but again, we left the door open throughout the process. It didn't matter if we'd been working together for 8 months and you had your portrait made, you could still turn around and say, this is not something I'm willing to do, because we definitely didn't want to publish anyone who wasn't ready.
Well, that idea of a space for essentially the testimony of the silent, right, of silent testimony, is, I think, a really significant innovation. I've never heard anything like that. And it's a really kind of creative solution to people who decide that they can't go forward in the process for whatever reason. One other thing for you, and then we'll move on. One of the big worries I know that a lot of young journalists have now is the fear that by asking people to recount traumatic experience or reflect on it, by asking these questions, we're re-traumatizing, we're reawakening, reopening old wounds. On this project in particular, how did you think about that? How did your protagonists, your collaborators, think about that?
I think it was really helpful that we didn't know what story we were going to tell at the end when we engaged with many of them. It was more of, we want to, you know, you raised your hand to share your story, which I think is a fundamentally different approach, because they had filled out this form and given us their name, their numbers, and their emails. So they had in some way said, you know, I want to participate in something. from there, I think much of the trauma that they wanted to share came in that first conversation. And that was a surprise to us, because I think they thought this might be my one shot to tell these reporters what happened to me. And little did we know that we'd be in touch for many, many more months ahead of them. But we really try to, it's impossible not to re-traumatize folks, I think, in some ways, shape or form, when they're gonna retell and help us shape something that will be for the public. But we try to only have one conversation where they retell it in the detail that they're comfortable. From there, we take different avenues to revisit, to re-examine, to decide what about this. And for many of them, they had been abused multiple times in a lifetime, right? Many of them had, their abuse began as children, and maybe by the time they were 30, they decided to say something or make a police report about it. So for a lot of these folks, we're speaking about lifelong trauma that was generational, where their grandparents had also endured parents. And so in many ways, it wasn't the elephant in the room was the trauma. And so they were very willing. I think many of our sources had done lots of therapy. And so they were very, very, you know, they were in so many ways had been waiting to do this.
Well, thanks. And we'll, again, come back and talk about this. And again, everyone, if you're just joining, or in case you've been so wrapped up in the conversation that you've forgotten, if you have questions, throw them into the Zoom Q&A function. We'll be getting to a kind of open question and answer session in a few minutes. We're now going to go to our third discussion group, Simon Schuster from Time, who reported Contagion of Fear, about Wycliffe Hospital in Brooklyn. Peter Prengeman and Raghu Vadaravu from the AP, who worked on Lives Lost, a kind of global chronicle of COVID deaths. Both of these clearly focusing in on the COVID-19 pandemic. Simon, I'm going to start with you for Contagion of Fear. You were embedded in a hospital in Brooklyn, along with Meredith Cohut, your wonderful photographer, in a very intimate way. We saw that little bit of video with an exhausted healthcare worker, a mortuary worker, talking about all the bodies and trying to process that. And one of the things you report in your story is hospital workers, this is at the height of the pandemic, when families cannot get in to see their sick relatives, people who are dying on ventilators, and yet you and Meredith are wandering around the hospital following healthcare workers around telling their story. How did you navigate that very difficult question, probably difficult for you as well as for the families and for the healthcare workers whose stories you were telling?
That was, you know, you really put your finger on it. That was the hardest part for me, psychologically, emotionally, being there and understanding that all of the family members of the people who were sick in this hospital could not visit them. Yet here we were, doing our job as journalists, but that was very hard to get across to the healthcare workers. Who were, you know, treating these patients, surprisingly often less so to the patients themselves. But the healthcare workers, it's a big hospital. So we're talking about 1,800 people. No matter how much we had, you know, discussed this with the hospital executives, the president of the hospital who let us inside initially, we were never going to really introduce everyone to our presence before we entered their clinical space. So there were inevitably going to be situations where we were coming into a place with patients where doctors are working, and they're like, who the hell are you? What are you doing here? Why are you here? What is this? Why is there a camera here? One thing that really helped was what we called the huddle, where we're entering a new clinical space, or even if we'd been there before, to take just a few moments to have someone in a position of authority in that space to introduce us, explain briefly what we're doing, who we are, why we're there, and just to get everyone kind of on the same page. It's often, I hesitated sometimes because we're taking time away from their treatment process, their work, but it ends up saving a lot more time because if we don't do that, there's just tension. They're sort of asking each other. They're distracted by our presence. So we tried to do that every time we entered a new situation, a new space in the hospital where we're seeing people for the first time, just to introduce ourselves and you know, explain why what we were doing and why it was important.
How did you navigate the tension between going wide and going deep? And you know, you've got a big hospital in a crisis that it has never been in, which New York City has never been in, which the world has never been in. You can go anywhere, talk to anybody, and you are trying to give a big picture, and yet you also do get this kind of deep intimacy at times with particular people. How did you make those choices?
That was more clear, I think, from the beginning, because we started with a clear event. It was the first patient to die of COVID-19 in the state of New York died in that hospital. It made headlines at the time. Very quickly, that one death was, you know, 10 and then 100, and it ballooned. But we began with that event. So the arrival of that patient at a time when the medical professionals were not yet being instructed to wear masks or goggles or protect themselves. So we started with that patient, and then we sort of built the picture out from that incident, the nurse and nurses who treated that patient, the ambulance workers who treated that patient and then had to isolate, the doctor who treated that patient. And we sort of built the picture in these concentric circles and getting to know the connections between the hospital staff who were somehow involved in this initial incident. And then as that ripple effect of the contagion, you know, the literal contagion of the virus spread through the hospital alongside what we called the contagion of fear, how those concentric circles interacted and kind of supported each other and dealt with the trauma that was sort of happening in real time as we were there.
Hmm. What about the visual choices, what ultimately made publication? There are some harrowing images of fully gowned in PPE folks treating people in a very kind of graphic physical way. There are images of grief, that really striking image of three healthcare workers grieving at a funeral. How did you decide what would be too much, what is too sensational, what depicts the social fabric of this particular community hospital? How did the two of you think about that, or the photo editors?
Yeah, I wish my colleagues were here to help on this question, because you know I'm the text guy. You know, I know that we had these conversations with Meredith, the photographer, about how far to go, what we can show. She was much more experienced than me in working in hospital settings and working with issues like patient privacy and all the legal and ethical implications involved in that. And for me, it was really learning on the job. That's less of an issue if you're a text reporter. It's still very much an issue. You know, you still have to be constantly conscious of protecting the privacy of patients. And it was both an ethical and a legal conversation, frankly, because we had to be very careful not to violate the privacy of patients who were not aware that we were going to be there or aware that they were going to be shown in a piece like this. You know, we had to be very deliberate in entering a space and, you know, even before you pick up your camera, making sure you have consent to show, you know, what people are willing to show. So it was a very complicated conversation in terms of, you know, what they decided to print. That's really a question for the photo editors that I wasn't involved in. Mm.
Peter and Raghu, let's talk about lives lost a bit. As I was going over today, my kind of reaction reading at this time was colored a bit by the recent 20th anniversary of September 11th and my vivid recollection of how the New York Times, after 9/11, building on what the Daily Oklahoman had done after the Oklahoma City bombing a few years earlier, came up with the idea of portraits of grief, of telling the stories of every survivor and of ordinary people's lives and reporting them out like full obituaries. You globalize this. You went with a global pandemic and decided to somehow tell a story using sort of that same idea, but that would span countries and cultures and continents. How did you do that? What were the kind of fundamental principles that you laid down at the beginning of this series of deeply reported pieces about whether it's how to choose people, what the reporting strategies would be? How did this come to be?
I could take a stab at that and then Raghu add to it. So in early 2020, I mean, it was clear that this was going to be horrific, that there were going to be, you know, millions who would likely die. I think I was drawn to this in part because I worked overseas for many years and covered a lot of tragedies and often felt like we covered them. We did what we needed to do, but we didn't go deep enough into the lives of, you know, the families and people who had lost people, because that's really what it's about. Once you lose somebody, it's everybody who's left behind. So I was really interested in that. And Raghu, who I've worked with for years, you know, was also drawn to this. And so we started talking among ourselves, among, you know, our other editors, like what could we do that could encompass the enormity of this, or at least try to, but be realistic about how we could do that? Because we thought about, you know, what the New York Times had done, what AP had done after, you know, 9/11, but this was gonna be much more than that, right? In 9/11, you had a certain amount of people that you could memorialize in some way, where this was gonna be so much larger. And so I think more and more we thought, well, we wanna do something that really goes deep on people's lives, that looks at the impact of people left behind, but that also captures the culture, religion, you know, of how death is dealt with around the world. And so I think that was kind of the genesis of what we wanted to do.
And Raghu, yeah. what were your instructions to your reporters? What did you tell people to do?
Yeah, I mean, I would just add one other thing to what Peter was saying. I mean, we've got this sort of collective trauma that's going on over the past year. Across the world, people are experiencing this. And one of the things that they were sort of deprived of was that sort of public memorial, being able to stand up in front of your community and say whatever you wanted to say about the life that, you know, it just kind of vanished, right? And so what we had tried to do is give, and this is sort of speaks to your, you know, the sort of the instructions to reporters. We wanted to be able to not just tell the stories of each of these individuals on the lives they lived, the sort of impact they had, you know, but also be able to give that instruction to say, can you ask them to record a sort of memorial that we would use in audio, that we could kind of, you know, this is your chance to be able to do that. And so, you know, we didn't want them to push. It was a one-time ask. And if they at any point during that process didn't feel comfortable with that, we would say, okay, we're not going to use it. But we always said that if they did supply that, we would always try to make a way to use it, whatever quality it was, because we wanted to honor, you know, the trust that they had put in us.
So it's so striking that you too, the AP too, like our colleagues in Alaska, deliberately chose a collaborative approach for this very intimate kind of storytelling, which again is so fresh and unusual in journalism terms, and I think is something that we're going to sit with as a profession for a little while and keep innovating around it. Let's open it up to Q&A from the room. Team Dart, if you could begin throwing stuff up onto the prompter for me, onto the monitor. While we're waiting for that, there we go. It's here. Many new journalists maybe want to know something about how you get that kind of access to families, what reporters go through, and whether this is true for any of you now, all of you here today, whether it's access to a hospital, access to family or friends of Mr. Floyd, access to the bereaved families. What are the single most important things any of you can think about for getting there? Any thoughts on that? Anyone want to sort of jump, unmute and jump in? Simon, did you have a, oh no, that's just your light, but I just, your light was there, but I'm going to ask you anyway, since I thought you were holding up your hand.
Yeah, I think patience and sensitivity. You know, we were in the environment where death and tragedy was happening all around us all the time. We were interacting with families, but the last thing that we wanted to do was sort of approach them in the middle of that, you know, with a microphone or a camera, and kind of attempt to do an interview when someone's, you know, really in the middle of a moment of grief like that. So we had the luxury of being able to take our time. This wasn't a news story. It was a long-term commitment that Time Magazine made to really be at that hospital over the long term. And because we met a range of victims of the pandemic, families, we were able to essentially show people that, first of all, we were very committed to the story, and take our time and slowly letting them invite us in, essentially, letting them talk. Yeah. We didn't push, but that ability to be patient was very important to give people a chance to speak up, you know, themselves and invite us in.
Saeed, I'm going to throw this one at you, because you also kind of embedded with this group of activists. And, you know, trust among activists in an outside storyteller is not necessarily going to be high. What kind of steps did you have to go through to win trust in this case? Whether of Derek individually to get all his Instagram posts and all that, or of the whole community that you were following really in the long run?
Yeah, I mean, I want to recognize that I think a huge advantage I had was I'm not that much older than a lot of them. I'm actually like their age in some ways. I'm their peer, and I communicated to them that at one point I was even in the activist space. So I think like there was like a foundational sort of relationship there. But that didn't necessarily mean that they trusted me like immediately from the onset. I think what I had to do is just show up. Show up and just listen, go to as many protests as possible. If they were marching to Harlem from Brooklyn, I was there. They were marching from Brooklyn to like Queens, I was there. And it hurt on my body, but ultimately, ultimately, when it came time for me to ask somebody for an interview, it was like, oh, this is just a guy who was like hanging around. I did have like a lot of anxiety about, their kind of mistrust or distrust of media and journalists. Mm-hmm. And what I would do is I would bring it up in conversation with some of them, like, hey, like, I'm trying to talk to this guy, but I feel like he doesn't really know me. And like, I really want to get closer to him to really like try to talk to him about this thing that happened. And it was funny because they're the ones who reminded me. Like one of them was like, yeah, just keep showing up, man. Like just keep hanging out and it'll eventually work out. And I was like, oh yeah, that's like a journalism 101 thing that you just reminded me of, and like came in handy.
Yeah. I have a kind of reporting and culture question for as many of you feel like answering it. You know, we're at a moment when questions of whose stories get told by whom is really alive in society. It's a living question, and it's alive in our journalism community. You each are bringing your own histories and your own identities. Some of you are reporters of color reporting within your own communities. Some of you are bringing complex experiences as an outsider to communities. Given the intensity of feeling around these issues, given the intensity of history that bears down on each of these stories, whether it is about the border and migrants and asylum, whether it is about police violence, whether it is about sexual abuse, especially in Indigenous communities, how did you navigate, either individually or in your teams, these very sensitive identity questions and entitlement to tell stories or represent images or do whatever? How did you think about that?
I can jump in here.
Please do.
I think the best thing we did was engage with the people who didn't want us there. Early in the project, we got a lengthy email forwarded to us from someone in a Native community who said, "What are you thinking by bringing these women from New York to an Arctic village in Alaska to have a roundtable about sexual assault in our community? Like, there could be no more harm than this, because they're going to leave and we're going to deal with the consequences of people sitting next to their perpetrator in these small remote communities who then, you know, obviously showed up with interest to this." I got on the phone with her and we talked and talked and talked, and in listening to the ways we could create harm in this community, we built around that, and we took it head on and said, "You're right, you know, we need resources for you there. We need to not flyer the community because that's dangerous for the people who live there," right? We had shown up with hundreds of flyers to invite people to an event to talk about sexual assault in a village. And that was, now looking back, so out of touch of us to want to do, because we were bringing the Western, you know, let's meet at the YMCA and sit around a table. And they had never had an event at their local community center, not much more, like much less one about sexual assault. So all of these cultural considerations, you have to take your time, and the people who don't want you there are part of your reporting as well. And this woman ended up being one of the prime profiles in the project and was our ultimate guide, because people trusted her, because she would speak up, and because she knew exactly where we could stumble into really tragic pitfalls. And so those people are incredibly important. They might not make it in the journalism, but they should surely shape your journalism.
And let me just alert Team Dart that we'll run over by 5 minutes or so, since we had that bit of a technical delay along the way. Anyone else want to leap in on this
Bruce,
one?
Bruce, I would jump in on this one. This was something we talked about a lot, Raghu and I, and with the team of reporters, you know, across the world, of really making sure that we were picking diverse subjects. I mean, and in all senses, right? You know, geographic, racial, age, gender, life circumstances, just to make sure we were really trying to reflect the whole world. That said, we were also really sensitive with this stuff, because if you reach out to a family and they're willing to tell their story and you start going down that road, you know, you're not going to say, "Oh, well, actually, we already did, you know, two pieces from the Middle East or something. Forget it. You know, we're not doing that," right? I mean, you have to be very, very sensitive with people. So a big part of our conversation, a big part of the subjects that we chose and greenlit, but also, you know, with a lot of compassion.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Maya, let me ask you that question about the Star Tribune in particular and the aftermath of Mr. Floyd's murder. You are a mostly white newspaper in a mostly white town. You have various kinds of diversity on that reporting team, but how did you navigate that within the team and think about this?
I know there was a little bit of concern with the fact that we're writing a story about, you know, a group of Black men who came to Minneapolis to get drug rehab treatment. And there would be some negative stereotypes at play that could be twisted, you know, by an audience. And it was kind of wondering how to tell that sensitively. And I know one reporter had brought up this issue of when Justine Damond was killed, did we delve into all this stuff about her background? She was a white woman shot and killed by a Black police officer in Minneapolis a couple of years before George Floyd. So I know there was just a lot of questioning about that. And ultimately, there was kind of this realization that how often in our newsroom or in any mainstream media do we get into such an in-depth profile of somebody of color. I mean, we certainly have not done it enough. So, you know, even though there were some difficult issues, you know, we had a chance to really humanize this person who had become a statistic and a symbol more than a real, you know, person being represented.
Yeah. And I guess I would just add to this equation that all of us as storytellers bring our own identities to the table, and it can be a source both of insight and vulnerability in our reporting. Sometimes people want to be talking to an outsider and may find it easier. Sometimes the insight that we have when we are closely identified with those we're reporting on is of enormous help. And it's a very, it's complicated math. I'm going to ask one more question for all of you, though you don't all have to answer it if you don't want. This has been a year like no other in the history of American journalism, or journalism elsewhere in the world for that matter. And you've each been immersed in a very full-on way in these particular, very, very intense projects involving large numbers of people, cascading events, even while our own lives have been disrupted by the pandemic. What did you do over the course of these particular projects? What do you do to take care of yourselves? What are your own strategies for this? Anyone want to leap in?
I would like to talk about this.
Okay, it's so really, go for it.
It's really hard. It's really difficult because I'm sure everybody here knows, like, when you're in a project or a story, it's like, at least for me, it's all consuming. I'm like calling people. I'm working on the writing. I'm working through tape. I really can't even think of my own life. And it's just something, and it's like, it's a big issue that I'm like trying to tackle in my life right now. So some things that I'm trying to implement right now is like really putting days aside, or at least hours aside, to really like practice self-care and take care of myself, because we are reporting on really heavy topics on our show. I have just gotten into a skincare routine. I do the whole facial spa thing at home now, which is great. I go to the gym, I play video games, I do anything but work, anything that makes me distracted from what it is that I have to do in front of me. But it's still a challenge, and I haven't gotten all the way through it yet, because yeah, when we get into these stories, it just like becomes so all encompassing and becomes like the only thing that we think about. And I think that's like something that we really should work on more. So I'd love to hear what other people are doing as well.
Anyone else got any great ideas?
Yeah, in my case, I try and talk to other colleagues about the stories that we report while we are on a trip, and try to understand which is the best way to tell those stories, and try to discuss everything, all the aspects of what people said. But also when Friday arrives in my life, I disconnect myself and I try to go have a run or play with my kid, and I turn off the computer and I forgot the world, because I think it is necessary, you know. I read the news, but I try not to work during the weekend or to review those stories, or during the night, for example. I don't read the stories or hear the testimonies before going to bed, because I won't sleep, you know? Yeah.
No, and it struck me that you have both these boundaries, these self-protection techniques, but also it is self-care to be talking through your stories with colleagues, making them as good as possible, and working problems out with colleagues rather than just on your own. Those are both kinds of self-care. One more. Anyone else want to?
Yeah, I could jump in.
Sure.
Hey. Thanks. So, I mean, I think last year was a real, I mean, it was very emotionally sort of draining. I don't think that I fully realized how much it was until January, at which point I think one of the things that I tried to start doing was get back into some art, you know, drawing, started doodling, got an iPad and started making things just to kind of like get out of the looking at, you know, sort of the doom scrolling and all of that. And I think the other thing that you just mentioned, you know, part of what we did throughout the year with my team in particular, but also with the reporters, you know, constantly checking in to make sure that people are not necessarily getting, you know, dragged down by every single story that we read. And I think being able to check in with one another, but then also having to that ability to sort of find a hobby that gets you out of the doom scrolling, I think is really helpful.
Okay, I think with that, that's as good a place as any to wind it up. I want to thank all of you for being wonderful panelists, but also you and all of your colleagues for being wonderful journalists and producing this work that is not only changing the lives of the people you report about, but changing how all of us as colleagues in journalism are going to look at these stories going forward. You are pathbreakers. I want to do a couple of other quick thank yous. I want to thank all of my colleagues on the DART Center team. I want to thank the DART Awards judges, a wonderful interdisciplinary team of combining journalists, clinical expertise, scholars. And I want to thank, in particular, the Kenneth B. DART Foundation, which has so generously supported the DART Center and the DART Awards for so many years. Most of all, thank all of you who are here in the room as part of the conversation. I'm sorry we couldn't get to all of your questions, but if you want to engage more, I would invite you to visit the DART Center website, www.dartcenter.org, where you'll find all of these stories completely posted in complete, along with all of the other DART Award winners going back to the Anchorage Daily News in 1994. And you'll find many other tip sheets, resources, and backgrounders, both on covering trauma and on self-care and being a good colleague for journalists. With that, I want to say goodnight to all of you. Be back next year, perhaps on Zoom, perhaps in person, perhaps in hybrid form, for the 2022 DART Awards. Thank you and good night.